First, I just want to thank staff for the opportunity and to the Glendale community to allowing me to come up here this morning and do my very first sermon. And I have to admit, it is very intimidating. You guys are intimidating. So our first scripture comes from Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Our second scripture this morning is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. I'm currently a student at Belmont University. I'll be 20 years old. So I'm trudging through. I'm studying social work. My end goal is to be a counselor. One of the things I want to focus on is spiritual direction. I want to be able to implement both of those into my individual group and family therapy. So I've reached out to a lot of mentors, advisors, professors at Belmont. It's my first semester, and they're very tired of me already. And what I've learned in this little bit of time is that when we say yes to God, we each do it in our own individual way. And I think that that's what makes it so special. And some of us are even still on that path of searching of what that means for them to say yes to God. I was recently challenged with a question at Young Adult this past Thursday. And he said, Alan, why do you want to be a United Methodist? Why do you want to be a member at Glendale? And it took me a second to answer that question. And I kind of paused for a second and I answered it, but I wasn't completely satisfied with my answer. So the way I am, that really bothered me. And so I was on my way home, and I kept thinking about that. And I got home, and it hit me. And the reason I want to become a member here at Glendale, and the reason why I love the United Methodist Church, is because I have felt I have been given the opportunity to say yes to God in my own way. And I think that that sums it up for me. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. I want to take a second real quick to speak about the welcome letter, or the welcome message that I give in the mornings. This idea that no matter where you come from or where you are going, you're welcome here. No matter what you believe or what you may be doubting, you're still welcome in these doors. No matter who you love, you're welcome here. No matter what you're searching for, if you're not sure what you're searching for, you're welcome here. And I think that that's what brings me back here every Sunday. And that's why I walk through these doors every Sunday. And this is how I say yes to God on Sundays. In one of my classes, it's a research class. It's a research in methods and social work class, and we watched a TED Talk. And the TED Talk was about, it was a qualitative researcher talking about how do we connect with people. And this was 6 years of research. She had planned on doing 1 year, and it took 6 years. It was 6 years of research. And what she found was that the way that people truly connect with one another, and how we show empathy to one another, and how we truly love one another, is by being vulnerable. It's by facing fear and going into situations where you're nervous and anxious and you're not sure how it's going to end up. So today, I hope that I connect with you because I feel very vulnerable. But what I learned from that TED Talk is that that's positive. And I hope you leave here this morning feeling connected. Maybe not with me, but connected with a family member who may be facing some sort of obstacle. Excuse me if I get emotional. Or connected with maybe something bigger and better than you, something that loves you unconditionally, God. I grew up in a very loving home. Very loving parents, two wonderful sisters, a wonderful education, a safe environment, Catholic education, St. Henry, Father Ryan. I always felt taken care of and loved. The problem was, I had obstacles with loving myself. I was very sensitive, very emotional. I still am very sensitive and very emotional. At 17 years old, when I was a young kid, I had a very strong faith. I had a close relationship with God. When I hit the age of 17, I started to lose that faith. I started to lose that relationship with God. And I started to get in the way. I started to try to control things in my own life. I had my first visit to Vanderbilt Psychiatric Hospital at the age of 17, where I was put on medication for depression. I had doctors saying, "You're depressed, Alan. You're bipolar. You have a lot of anxiety." And facing these things, I think I was looking for an outlet, and that's when I discovered alcohol, and shortly thereafter, drugs. 19 years old was my first time in a 30-day treatment center. And at 21, I was back in Vanderbilt Psych Hospital, put on different medications, trying to figure out a solution to certain problems. And my solution became alcohol. My solution became drugs. It started to quickly take over my life. My life became unmanageable. I didn't love myself. I didn't know how to love other people. I had no purpose. I had no aspirations, no dreams, no goals. Suicidal ideation was very much a part of my life. It was always a solution for me on a daily basis. I always thought, well, this is a way out. I would go back to treatment for the second time, inpatient, 30 days. I would again go back to treatment for an intensive outpatient for about 25 sessions. And all along these different visits, I could not stay sober. I was in and out of hospitals, in and out of detox centers, put on medication. I'd stay sober for a little bit, and then I would get back in the way. It would become about my will, and I would try to control things and think that I could drink successfully. And each time, I was proven wrong. I would wake up in the morning not knowing what happened, where I was, who I was with. I'd have to go look at my car in the morning to make sure I didn't hit another car, something else, or someone. That was the routine of my life. I couldn't keep a job. My family was losing all trust in me. My parents didn't sleep at night, constantly worrying about me. My sisters didn't sleep. And there was a time when it wasn't safe for me to be around my niece by myself because I wasn't trusted. I was dropped off in my sister's yard one morning by someone who didn't know what to do with me. I think I had about 4 different drugs in my system at that time, hallucinating, seeing things, threatening my life. My sister had to drop everything in her own life, didn't know what to do with me, took me to Vanderbilt once again. This was routine. This was normal for me and for my family. My parents got a call 2-3 o'clock in the morning. I was living in Murfreesboro at the time. And they were told that they needed to come to Murfreesboro to the hospital because your son is here. I had tried to overdose and was having my stomach pumped. And that's the news my parents got in the morning. I don't know what it was about July 18th of 2013. I went on another, what I call a binge. I would go on binges for a few days. I was handcuffed, put in the back of a cop car. I somehow got out of that situation and woke up at home. I had gotten a hold of more drugs that night after I was released from the police. And I woke up on July 19th of 2013, and I put my hands up, and I said yes to God, to something bigger and better than me. I stepped out of the way. I admitted that I was powerless, my life was unmanageable, and I needed to do something different. It was the darkest place I had been. I didn't care about living. But there was so much I wanted to do with my life. So I have now been sober for 4 years, and my life is completely different. My family trusts me. I have healthy relationships. I have a healthy relationship with other people. I have a healthy relationship with myself. And most importantly, I have a healthy, big, and beautiful relationship with God. That is what keeps me going every day. A month ago, I was offered a job at Cumberland Heights Treatment Center, where I was a patient 3 times. There's a window that you walk up to when you're being admitted there. I walked up to that window 3 different times with my head down in some of the darkest moments of my life, full of shame, guilt, I now work on the other side of that exact same window, where I can give hope and healing to other people. That is saying yes to God. When I first got sober, I got a job at Gaylord Hotel. I had been sober for about 2 months, and I was still obsessing over alcohol and drugs. It was constantly on my mind. So I made $3.50 an hour. I relied on tips. I had a lady, we would hang out in the lobby waiting on people to come in, and then we'd run right up to you, hoping that maybe you had a $20 bill or more. I had a lady come in and I hear, "Sir, sir." And I turn around and I see this lady. And I could immediately tell that she was blind. And I quickly gathered her luggage and helped her to her room. And she said, "Now for the next 3 days, I'm gonna need someone to bring me to all my different groups, my different conventions. And I'll be honest, in my head, I'm thinking, well, are you going to take me?" I went to my boss trying to figure out what to do, because again, I made $3.50 an hour. In that moment, we discussed it and I decided that I would go and help this lady get where she needed to go. For those 3 days, it was the first time in my life when I did not think about taking a drink or using a drug. I got outside of myself and I helped someone else. I stopped thinking about my own obstacles, my own problems, and I started to think about someone else. This was the first time that I think true humility hit my life, and it clicked. I recently spoke with a father who was trying to get his son into treatment, and he finally got his son into treatment. And he looked at me and he said, "Alan, I don't think anything is about luck." And I told him, I completely agreed. I don't ever say good luck or things in my life, I got lucky. It's more about I have been blessed and it has been God working in my own life. I had a pretty bad car accident in my active addiction and alcoholism, and I had multiple car accidents, but this was the worst. I woke up in the hospital, I had no idea what had happened. I didn't know if I had killed someone, hurt someone. There was 4 other people in the car on I-65 South, and I hit them going over 90 miles per hour. Their car flipped. That was not luck. That was God working in my life and working in those other people's lives. Saying yes to God looks so different for all of us. Maybe saying yes to God for you is just about being kind to someone today. Maybe saying yes to God is just being willing to search for saying yes. Maybe saying yes to God is even sometimes doubting. Maybe saying yes to God is just holding the door open for someone else. Maybe saying yes to God is asking for help. Maybe saying yes to God is just about being honest or just about feeling. And I'll end with this. I challenge each of you to step out of the way and attempt to say yes to something bigger, better, beautiful, and full of unconditional love. God reaches for us to say yes. We all face challenges with many different obstacles. We each have our own story. This just happens to be mine. Are we free or are we unfree? When we say yes to God, we choose freedom. And we can move forward through our obstacles. Each of us, as individuals, is worthy. I will never forget when someone looked at me and they said, "You are worth the effort, Alec." So I tell you each today, you are worth the effort. You are worth the effort to love life, love self, and love God. Go give God a yes today. Reach out to an outcast. Say a prayer for an enemy. Say a prayer before bed tonight. Talk to a stranger and even love your enemy. Welcome all people with love and kindness. Galatians chapter 5, verse 14. For everything we know about God's world is summed up in a single sentence. Love others as you love yourself. That's an act of true freedom. Live as God has created you to live, happy, joyous, and free. If you will join me in prayer. Dear Lord, I have never been good at saying yes. Fear and hesitation make me doubt my abilities. I don't want to live in fear anymore. I don't want to miss out on the opportunities you have for me. I pray that I can say yes with confidence. I pray to say yes to adventures, to stepping out of my comfort zone, to loving people. Be my confidence and my courage. Remind me daily that I am able, and that you are with me, and that I am in your will. I love you, Lord, and I desire to honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. And something that I read, and I'll end with this, something that John Wesley said. One of the principal rules of religion is to lose no occasion of serving God. And since he is invisible to our eyes, we are to serve him in our neighbor, which he receives as if done to himself in person, standing visibly before us. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.
Respond to Alan's very inspirational, powerful word this morning. With the gift of love in the hymnal 408, please stand as you are able.